All right, and I believe we are streaming. Looks like I've got good signal strength. All right, well, hey, welcome folks to a Comic Tropes live stream. Do these every once in a while when I can find the time and just spend some time noodling around with either drawing, in this case, inking, sometimes coloring, and primarily it's just an outlet for me to interact with all of you. So if you have any questions, feel free to just shout out. And if I miss you, it's not me ignoring you at all. It's only that every once in a while I'll be looking down at my artwork, so I miss some stuff. That said, let's see. Hello to Zach Couch. What is this? Miguel, Nipper, J. Andrew World, Atomicus Video Studios, the Watchful and Harmonious Subscriber, Corbin and Comics, Arcade Den, Swoosh McJord, and I'm just messing with some settings while I speak. A friend of mine had a tough financial situation come up, so he launched a GoFundMe, and in order to support it, I told him I would do 10 illustrations, and somebody could request a character. We've gotten six requests so far, and this will be my third drawing. I did Captain Marvel. Still need to finish a few things on that one. Apparently, this character, and I know I won't pronounce the name right, but Naruto. Somebody requested that character. I hope I got it right. And Star Lord. So I've been sort of dicking around all day, just trying to get this to look like Star Lord. And I used, if you've ever seen those Hot Toys figures, they're like $300. I collect the ones for like the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Not every single one, but a bunch of them. I used my figure here as reference. That's what I used. So anyway, awesome folks here. Any plans on a Steve Lieber or Whiteout episode? Oh, that might be a nice idea. I've met that guy. Super friendly. Very talented. I do like Whiteout. Not so much the sequel, but Whiteout is a great comic. Maybe someday I will do that. So hello to everybody that's jumping in. That's really awesome to see so many folks today. Today's one of my days off, one of my few days off, and just trying to bang out a couple illustrations per the requests I've been getting. Anyway, I guess this is more or less set to ink. So you know what? Screw it. I'm putting down the pencil and start with the outlines. Any questions yet? Let's see. The Tick, the Max, Golden Age, Daredevil. Are those all like requests? I can tell you that one of those three is coming up very soon. Drawing Star Lord to celebrate James Gunn's return. Just sort of a coincidence, actually, on that one. Like I said, this was just a requested commission. So just gonna do my best on that, and we'll see how this all goes. Using a medium-sized brush pen for the outlines, and then we'll dive in deeper with something finer for some of the interior lines. Have you ever drawn your own comic? Yes, technically. They've all been. No, sorry, they've not all been. I've done a lot of self-published stuff in the past. Collaborating with other sort of indie artists, and I've also worked freelance on a few anthology graphic novels. Those are more educational comics, and but yeah, it still counts. It's the kind, so in those books are things that you could find at, Barnes and Noble or Amazon and your library and stuff like that. So a little bit, not a lot, not a lot. But one of them that I did was nominated for an Eisner that year for best anthology. So Sometimes I remind myself about that. Did you hear the new Burial Grid album is coming out tomorrow? No, I did not hear that. Sorry. What are your hobbies? I wouldn't say that I've got a lot of time these days for hobbies, but drawing is definitely one of them. I loved illustrating. I find that very relaxing. So drawing, hiking when I can. I love movies. I love comics. You know, it all sort of relates to the stuff that I've sort of turned my hobbies into work, which I don't necessarily recommend. But anyway, what are your thoughts on Marvel and Fox are now one? You know, it's actually a little scary to have one company have so much power. And I did read that their first move basically was to lay off 7,500 people that used to work for Fox. They just became redundant because Disney already had a lot of people that do the same job. So they let a lot of people go. You know, I'm trying to be happy about like the nerdy stuff. You know, we might now now Disney has the rights to release the original Star Wars trilogy, or at least that first movie. That used to be something that Fox, 20th Century Fox, owned. The very first one. So now they could release that. And I personally far prefer the original Star Wars to those special editions. I really don't care for those. That's pretty nerdy of me, I know, but you know, I'm hopeful that they'll release those, in other words. And you know, of course, I'm excited about the Marvel Cinematic Universe being able to use Doctor Doom or the Silver Surfer, Wolverine, but yeah, at the end of the day, it's sort of like just scary to think of one company owning so much intellectual property and having so much power, if you want my honest opinion. And I love Disney. I sincerely do. Should WB rehire some people from Fox to WB for the movie? Yeah, sure. Of course they could. Oh, I got a super chat. I'm sorry that I missed that, but that's lovely. Let me see here. This says what? Pineapple Pizza Fan. If you haven't heard, Frank Miller is teaming up with John Romita Jr. to create Superman Year One. Well, both of those creators have done plenty of stuff that I really love. Frank Miller was a weirdo for a long time, but he actually seems to be kind of calming down and making some apologies for some of his odd behavior. So, I don't know. That said, I skipped Dark Knight 3 or whatever it was called. So I don't know where his writing skill is these days. But I'm definitely a big fan of John Romita Jr. So that's kind of cool. It's definitely still big news, and it's amazing when you can be relevant in this industry where, you know, there is actually a lot of change. It's amazing to sort of maintain your relevancy for as long as Frank Miller has. And actually, now that I think of it, John Romita Jr. too. He's actually been working a very long time in comics. So that's kind of awesome. What else? Who is my pick to replace Kevin Tsuchihara for CEO at WB? I have no idea. Me. Am I going to San Diego Comic-Con this year? No, I'm not. But congratulations, Keitai, on getting your pro badge. That's awesome. Very cool. I'd love to go. Really just don't have the time or the budget to do that right now. But that would be dope. I am planning right now on going to the New York Comic-Con this year. So that will be kind of exciting. Superman in a noir setting. Weird. Vid on Calvin and Hobbes. Yeah, people have actually asked me a few times before to consider Calvin and Hobbes, and I've definitely given it some very serious thought. There are certain comic strips I would like to discuss, and of the more recent modern ones, Calvin and Hobbes would be one. Far Side might be another. Not sure about that, because there isn't really sequential storytelling there, so I'm not sure. Oh, wow. Okay, another super chat from Pineapple. Have I watched Doom Patrol? No, it looks very, very cool. I appreciate all the support you guys give me with things like super chats and that. But even so, my budget is pretty thin. I definitely can't afford each of the streaming services or anything that I want. I don't have cable right now. I have one outlet. I have Netflix and I have YouTube. That's pretty much it. That if it's not on Netflix or YouTube right now, I'm not getting to see it. That's cool to see so many people like the Doom Patrol. My favorite Spider-Man storyline. That is tough. Big fan of the original Sinister Six by Stan Lee and Steve Ditko. Big fan of Kraven's Last Hunt, which I've reviewed on the channel before. But I think, of course, One More Day is definitely... No. I couldn't even say it without laughing. Which was better in the 90s, Wildcats or Youngblood? Wildcats. Not like either of them were fantastic, but I definitely dug the art on Wildcats more, if I had to choose. I was a fan of Get Out. I own that one, and I definitely plan to see Us as soon as possible. I've not seen Scooby Apocalypse, but I had read how I was really upset to see that, like, Warner Brothers didn't really let Matthew Lillard know that they were letting him go. That guy has been voicing Scooby-Doo since, like, when did the first Scooby-Doo live-action movie come out? That was, like, I don't know. I want to say early 2000s or something. So, I can draw Marvel Man at some point, but I do have some commissions right now. So, they apparently, Warner Brothers has been using, like, you know, Matthew Lillard for a long time now, like over a decade, as the voice of Shaggy. And by all accounts, people really enjoyed his work there. And then they hired Will Forte for, like, their most recent project. And they didn't tell Matthew Lillard. He just found out on Twitter, which is kind of rough. Yeah, since 2004. So that's like 15 years. That's a really lengthy run as a character, an important sort of character. And I just think that's kind of crappy to not really give a guy a heads up, like, hey, you've been doing a great job, but, you know, we want to go in a different direction. Like, how hard is it to make a phone call like that? People are cowards. I just feel like that's a... If you had a regular ongoing gig for, like, 15 years, and then one day you went on Twitter, and you were just like, wait, I'm not doing the next one? Alan Moore's run on Wildcats was actually pretty good. Yeah, and he had, the artist was Travis Charest, moving into his awesome height of his talent. I have not heard of the Junji Ito exhibit, but I would go to something like that in a heartbeat. Junji Ito is, I mean, he is horror comics at this point. As awesome as the stuff that EC Comics was doing in the 50s, that's a long time ago at this point, and I don't think anybody's come close to what Junji Ito is doing for horror comics right now. Well, maybe in terms of popularity. I mean, The Walking Dead is still pretty damn popular, so that's probably worth mentioning. But yeah, Junji Ito, man. That guy's dope. I've been following that cat for a while. Has anyone been reading Marvel Comics long enough to remember what Star-Lord used to look like back when he was published in, like, Marvel's black and white magazines and stuff? Honestly, like, almost a completely different character. If you hear any background noise, like screeching, I've got a window open because it's a pretty warm day out here, and across from me is a grade school, so there are some kids playing like on the playground right now. Just letting you know, because it's kind of a weird sound. What is your past con experience? How was your past con experience? Oh, I love conventions. Are you a fan of martial law? Yeah, that's definitely a comic I would like really enjoy reviewing sometime, for sure. I'm just reaching to my side here to get a template for something. And then I'll be right back, folks. Say, want to hang out sometime? I'll say hello to anybody if they're at, like, you know, a convention or anything like that. Got to see a few nice folks, a few of you up there. We're at the Emerald City Comic Con last week, and got to say hello. A few nice folks stopped me, and that was awesome. That was really nice. I have read the IDW Turtles. In fact, one of my very first reviews on this channel reviewed one of them, so that was awesome. Let's see. How is my... Star-Lord used to fly and wear a skin-tight costume. He sure did. He sure did. Just trying to figure out, like, what size I want to use for this. I think it's going to be this guy. I'm getting a little quiet just because I'm using this template just sort of in my own headspace. I'll be right back to everybody in a sec. There we go. Not perfect, but not bad. What was up with the early 2000s Nazi Star-Lord? Don't remember. Don't think I read that. Since Marvel Comics now owns the Marvel Man, Miracle Man character, any idea why they're not using him at all? You know, they haven't talked about it in detail, but apparently some of those rights are still a little bit up in the air. Oh, thank you for the super chat, Matthew. That's sincerely appreciated. I really do appreciate that stuff. It helps a lot. Because I don't think they've actually reprinted the full run. Like, have they? I don't think that they've gotten to the Neil Gaiman stuff yet. I don't think Shazam is exactly a copy of Superman. He's a strong guy, and he can fly, but he doesn't have all of Superman's other powers. He's not from an alien planet. He's supernaturally based. Costume definitely looks very different. I'll discuss it very soon in a video. So, definitely something I've thought about, but yeah. One time somebody said on one of these live streams, "Hey Chris, you don't seem to rotate your art very much when you draw. Is that like for all of us?" And I said, "Actually, kind of, yeah. But I'm rotating it slightly right now." In order to get the angle that I want. There was a lawsuit between DC and Fawcett over Superman. There was. I haven't won the caption contest yet. Thank you, Chris. one of my favorite things to do every week for folks that don't understand what that's a reference to is the New Yorker has a weekly, usually weekly, every once in a while they skip a week. They have a weekly caption contest. They put a cartoon up and you're supposed to come up with some really funny caption for it that makes it complete. And one thing I actually learned recently is that the cartoonists that submit it actually already have a great punchline. So like the winner is basically the person that will match that. And I guess sometimes they can beat it, but basically the person that like guesses the correct punchline wins. But what I do for the weekly caption contest is I always enter the first thing that enters my head. Like, it's always a really bad, mundane thing, like, oh, hi, or this soup doesn't taste good. You know, like, it's complete anti-comedy. And then I present it with pride and confidence that this week I'm finally going to win the New Yorker caption contest. Let me, I don't have my phone, so I can't pull one up. Let's see. Another super chat from Pineapple Pizza Fan, the Pineappling. You can read Gaiman's Marvel Man. Morrison's Marvel Man was canceled, I guess. I don't know if it's canceled or if it's like indefinitely delayed. I have read the full Marvel Man run. I've read both, the Gaiman stuff and the Alan Moore stuff. It's interesting. It's very interesting. Gaiman stuff I didn't connect with quite as much, but it's not bad at all. I really did like what Alan Moore did with it. But at this point, I've just seen so many deconstructions that I kind of like the first ones that I read, and now I'm kind of burnt out on the idea of just trying to, like, put superheroes in a more realistic world. You know, like, after you've read Brat Pack and Watchmen and Miracle Man, it's like, I don't know. It's hard to think that there's a lot more to say. But if somebody wants to try, I'll give it a shot. You know what I'm saying? Just because I don't think there's anything more to say doesn't necessarily mean that I'm right. But yeah, in general, I'm a little burned out on that. Is Alan Moore's run on Supreme worth a read? You know what? I actually can't give an informed opinion on that. I haven't read it yet. I also have always heard that it's quite good, but I haven't read it yet, so I don't know. But I've heard that he definitely changed it up from just being a typical Superman riff. I heard that, but I don't know if that's the case. Some of you out there probably have read it and have a more informed opinion than I do. How goes the drawing? You know, it's getting around. Would you say Black Hammer is a deconstruction or more of an homage? Tough to answer. But I am planning on doing an episode about it, you know, in the nearish future, so I'll come to a conclusion on that pretty soon, but you'll have to wait for the episode on that one. Is that Naruto? Yes. I've been doing some commissions, so I still have to color this guy, but that was my take on Naruto, a character that I have to admit I don't really know very well. So I just watched a bunch of clips. I looked at a bunch of illustrations from the comic, and I just sort of came up with my take on it, I guess. And then I also had done Captain Marvel fairly recently. So just working on some commissions these days, trying to bang these out, as they say. Thanks for all the interesting questions this time. This is great. Definitely keeping me motivated to just keep drawing. Not going to notice the time pass by if I've got plenty of interesting questions to answer. Speaking of Alan Moore, have you read The Ballad of Halo Jones? Not yet. That's one that's sort of a blank spot in my history. Gotta read that one. Am I excited about James Gunn returning? I am. You know, I don't think we should downplay exactly what he had said, but I do think that, like, you know, he didn't deserve to be punished the way he did. He was trying to be funny, and I feel like, personally, I give people a lot of latitude when they are trying to make a joke, because it's actually kind of, it's hard to make a good joke, and I don't think we should be punished for missing, you know? I'm a big fan of punching up, not down. So his statements didn't really actually, they weren't that funny to me, but I'm also not a kind of guy that will actually get offended. So it didn't offend me. I could understand why it offended some other people, but I also don't think that it really represented who he was or if getting fired made sense. And to Disney's credit, I think that they also came around to going like, yeah, maybe this is a bunch of manufactured controversy. Because I think he's done a really great job with Guardians of the Galaxy. I really like those movies, especially the first one. So I'm definitely excited that he's coming back. Be curious about all of you. Holy moly! Wow! Look at this super chat. Good gosh. Can you do a spotlight on Alan Davis or Hirohiki Araki's inspiration for his character art design in JoJo's Bizarre Adventure? Comic tropes is better or greater than Comic Explained. I don't know what that is. Is that a blog or a website? I definitely don't know. It's like comparing a TED Talker speaker to an MTV VJ. Well, I appreciate the kind words. I sincerely appreciate that, as well as that super generous donation. The answer is absolutely yes to both of those. Alan Davis has definitely been on my sort of potential topics for quite a while. Definitely somebody that I can't wait to dive into someday. And a lot of viewers have asked me to cover JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. I haven't read it yet. I will buy it and give my thoughts, but I want them to be informed thoughts. So I need to, the first thing I need to do is read that, and that's going to take some time in between making the other episodes. So I would love to make an episode about JoJo's Bizarre Adventure this year, if possible. Just know that it's definitely on my radar, definitely. No, I did not hear about the Blade Runner 2021 comic coming up. That's interesting. Do I think that the Guardians were more influenced by Farscape than the comic book? Not necessarily. I see where you're coming from there. You know, it's a cast of weirdos, but they did kind of... No, I think that, like, they were taking some pretty heavy inspiration from the comics at the time. And possibly also, I guess I sort of felt like, if anything, maybe some Cowboy Bebop in there a little bit. That was just my two cents. It's possible that, like, you know, Farscape inspired them a bit, but I'm not sure. The hunter is named Ash. Who's publishing Blade Runner 2021? I don't know that one. When you feel overwhelmed, what are some things you do to try and center yourself or de-stress? Wow, that's a really positive question. That really is. And I'll be honest, no hurt, feline. It's a challenge for me. I suffer from depression and anxiety in a major way. I do a few things. I keep busy with work, including, like, the work that I'm giving myself. I try to socialize with my friends. That's the toughest, because of, like, my work schedule does not lend itself to being available on most weekends. So that's a little bit of a challenge to socialize properly. I try to exercise a bit, and that's definitely something I did not do a great job at. I need to exercise a lot more. I used to exercise a lot more and I don't right now. Those three things can all help me. But if I just need like a moment of zen, I call it, like if I just need to really just chill, one of my favorite things to do, not something I can always afford to do, is get a Lego set, turn on a podcast, either comedy or maybe like true crime, but usually comedy, and just spend, you know, a couple hours just listening to people talking, hopefully being funny, and just build Lego. I'm following directions, click, 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 I'm building something. I don't know, it really, that is my favorite thing to do. But I also, these days, I'm trying not to spend too much on, like, stuff. So, that's a challenge. Really interesting, positive question. I'd definitely be curious what other people do, too. What's my day job? Yeah, I actually sell used cars these days. My background is in marketing. That's what I got my college degree in. That's what I did for, like, 15 years. I moved out across the country for a job. It downsized. I don't know a ton of people out here. I need to pay the bills, so I got a job selling used cars, at least for now. It's not that bad. It's definitely never something I thought I'd be doing. You know? It's weird. What's the worst superhero ever created? You know, I probably a lot of the stuff that I review in like sort of weird golden age stuff. I think that Civilian Justice was tremendously misguided. I think that 7-Eleven is probably my personal favorite weird hero from the past. Although he's not exactly a superhero. He's more like a pulp detective guy. But he intentionally gets locked up for a crime that he didn't commit. Like, he looks just like his best friend, and his best friend committed a crime. So he goes to jail in his place, and then he tunnels out and fights crime every night. And then in the morning, he sneaks back into jail. And he lives in jail. Jay Muse, I didn't realize that you were a lobster fisherman in Nova Scotia. That's awesome. I think that that's very respectable and super hard work. Power to you. I grew up in a fishing village. I grew up south of Boston. I grew up on the East Coast, surrounded by lots and lots of fishermen and fishing families. I have a lot of respect for it. It is very tough, sometimes dangerous work, depending on the season and the weather. And also, one of my great grandparents came down from Nova Scotia. They had been living there, like the family, for a long time. So, kind of a cold area, but beautiful, definitely beautiful. Got a lot of respect. Who here is from the furthest away? Do we have anyone from, for instance, outside the U.S.? Anyone outside the U.S. today? Anyone from? Let's see who the furthest person away is, if we can. If you think that you're in the running, like, just sort of speak up with where your home country is, and we'll see if we can all figure out who the furthest from me, and I'm living in Seattle. All right, so London, Canada, Mexico, Australia, two Australias. Australia is probably the furthest from me. It's going to be harder to get more remote than that. Just outside London, Ireland, Argentina. Hopefully you appreciated my recent review about El Eternat. Eternata? Yeah. Wow, look at this. So many people from outside. Nigeria. Cool. Toronto. Krypton. Krypton is further away than anywhere on Earth. Krypton wins. The Netherlands. Malaysia. Jeez. This is so cool that there's so many of you from outside of America. I thought that, like, I mean, I know that the majority of my viewers is in America because I can look at analytics. But this is fascinating to see that I've got so many people, like, that are watching. I'm very grateful. And if I were rich, what I'd want to do with my time is I'd want to make comics or at least talk about them. And I'd want to travel. That's what I love doing. It breaks my heart to think that there's so much of this world that I'll probably never get to see, at least in deep detail. I'm utterly fascinated by humanity's accomplishments and history. I love trying new foods and exploring old ruins. I love it. So everywhere you just listed is a place I would love to visit. I'm not kidding. Everywhere. The last big trip I took was this time last year. If you have been watching the channel for a little while, you might remember that I did episodes in Tokyo and Hong Kong this time last year. And probably no big trip this year. Doesn't seem financially wise. But I think that next year, if you know, we keep sort of like saving properly, my fiance and I, that we definitely have considered both Greece and New Zealand as places we would very much like to go. Hello from Argentina. That's awesome. Connor, I would love to go to Australia. Would love it. Why does Star-Lord wear a trench coat in space? Because he doesn't always live in space. He goes on planets. And dusters are cool. Dusters are cool. As much of a shame it is not getting to experience it all in the world, at the very least, we all experience many of the same things in our own way. That's a really good point. What is at the top of your list of places to go if you had unlimited funds? Okay, if I had unlimited funds right now, like I just said, I'm trying to decide between Greece and New Zealand. I would also love to do something like go down to the tip of Argentina and maybe take a cruise or something to Antarctica. I think that would be really unique. I would like to go on a safari in Africa, maybe South Africa, maybe. I would love to see the pyramids and the Nile River and stuff, so maybe Egypt, something like that. I would love to travel across Europe. I love German food, so I'd love to go to Germany. Oh, wow, look at this. I'll interrupt myself briefly to say thank you so much to Craig, that's C. Kim there. Toronto FanCon, invite sent as long as I see Tim Cook episodes. Okay. Bruce Tim might be further out. Darwin Cook is an absolute possibility. Huge, huge fan of Darwin Cook. It's really sad that we don't still have him. He was quite a talent. I'd love to go to Toronto. That's cool. Pick Greece. That way you can have authentic Italian food. I've been to Italy. What a treat. What an experience. Rome and Venice I've been to. What a treat. L.S. Grieger says, I saw the Taj Mahal in India. That was amazing. You know, one regret I have, my brother-in-law married my stepsister, and he's originally from India, and they had their wedding in India. I was invited, and it broke my heart. I couldn't afford to fly out at the time. They had a second wedding here in America, and I went to that one. I would have loved the opportunity to go and experience India with essentially extended family. That would have been amazing. I would have loved to have seen the Taj Mahal. It was the wedding was in the Mumbai area, and I wish I could have done that. I really like my brother-in-law. He's a smart, funny dude, and it would have been a real treat to have been able to go there. Hopefully someday in the future I still can. That would be very special to me. All right, I'm going to start like throwing down some thick blacks to try to sort of determine where I want to add the detail, because there's certain areas I definitely want to sort of offset the drawing with deep blacks. So we're going to take a moment to do that for a sec. Thank you for the follow-up super chat, C. Kim. Trust me, Darwin Cook is... I just want there's certain episodes where it's about a creator or a comic that's very special to me, and I know it'll take me a little longer than usual to sort of do that episode. A lot of these episodes, you know, I do more or less in a week, but some of them I start the research and the writing ahead of time. I've got some in the works at all times. I've got like a handful. And Darwin Cook is just somebody that, like, you know, he meant something to me, and I'd want to do an extra good job if possible. So I don't want to, like, rush that and just say, oh, here's a week where I don't, like, have a topic chosen. Like, I'll just do Darwin Cook. I want to, like, try to find an angle on that, in other words, so that I can sort of do a bit of a deep dive. You know, whether that's selecting one of his works or deciding to just do his full history, I don't know. I'd prefer to analyze some of his techniques, so I don't know. Just something I'm thinking about. Oh, wow. Dude, I'm having all the luck with you guys tonight. Finn Park, thank you, first of all. Thank you. And let's see what you have to say. Your channel has gotten me through really rough days at work and life, but your video on Mike Allred X-Force X-Statics run convinced me to drop almost $200 on comics. Now I'm poor. I would like an apology. No, I can't apologize. I think you got like your $200 worth, right? Hopefully you enjoyed that. I mean, if you were convinced to give it a shot, I really hope that you did enjoy it. I love that. I love that run for what they decided to do. I found it like, yeah, that's black satire, not the blackest, but it's some dark stuff. And it's kind of amazing that Marvel hasn't like found a way to try to roll those characters into, you know, one of the X-Men titles and keep using them. Like, those characters were Milligan and Allred's, and looks like that's how they'll pretty much stay, which is very, very rare for creations in the Marvel or DC universe. Very rare indeed. Someday they'll be back, but hopefully not for a while. That's awesome. Are there any particular arcs of Mr. Cook's that you can recommend as a starting point? Yeah, I would say, what's his Justice League comic that was set during the Cold War? New Frontier? Can someone out there like confirm if I'm remembering that title correct? New Frontier? I'm pretty sure that's the one. I think that that's a pretty good starting point for what he does with both art and writing. And then I personally really liked his Parker books. Do you mind if I ask what you regularly charge for a commission? Well, first of all, I don't always have them open because I'm not always available, and I only want to be able to do it if I can do it in a timely manner. Normally, I would charge for something like this, I would charge like $60. And for this friend's GoFundMe, I'm charging $50 to try to, like, you know, attract the anybody that's interested right now. There are still 4 slots left. If you go to like my Twitter or something, I think I posted it there. Anyway, I don't have my phone right next to me, so I can't really confirm that. But my friend's name is Paul, and his girlfriend Aria. They live in a bad neighborhood, unfortunately. It wasn't necessarily that bad when Aria bought the house, but it has become dangerous. They've had bullets punch through their walls. They've had corpses found in the dumpster around the corner. It's bad. Basically, there's a nearby slumlord that keeps renting his house to drug dealers. And this is in like the sort of Milwaukee region, more or less. And it's become quite a bad, dangerous neighborhood. And they're doing everything they can to save up to get a new place. And I can't quite go into the full details, but they had a financial setback, and so that's a hassle. And so they're just trying to raise $5,000 so that they can get out of there. And it's frustrating. You know, they both work, and they just need like a little bit of a boost to try to get out of there. So if I can help by donating some sketches, I'm happy. That's the least I can do for my friend. Hopefully, like, you know, somebody finds $50 for like a sketch like this, finds that to be a fair price, and that helps my friend at the same time. I can donate that kind of my time to help him. But anyway, just explaining what's going on. Qbert, let's see. Am I ever going to do anything on Joe Kubert? He was a terrific artist and he brought a lot of talent to the comics industry. No question I'll do something on Joe Kubert. I mean, he founded the cartoonist school. He did Sergeant Rock and a lot of like realistic like war comics, like based on like true stories in his later years. There's a lot to appreciate about Joe Kubert. So yeah, I'll definitely at some point cover him. You know, I hope my show will go on for a long time and I can't cover everybody every week. So some of these, it might take a while to get to. I can't promise anything off the top of my head. I can tell you that in the near future, I'm probably going to be covering the original Captain Marvel, The Tick, Black Hammer, what else? It's eluding me now. I've just got a list of like five or six that are coming in the somewhat near times. Anyway. J. Andrew World, sorry for your illness. Wait, you're sick? My advice is to either take up late night improvisational tap dancing, always a good idea, or buy your daughter a drum kit for her birthday. Maybe neighbor reconsider smoking. How much Monica in that Captain Marvel video? No, not that Captain Marvel. I'm talking Shazam. Shazam Captain Marvel, the original Captain Marvel is who I'm talking about. Monica Rambeau is somebody that I'd like to talk about, but I would like to talk about her in the context of one of my favorite comics that I think is severely underrated, Next Wave. Next Wave with art by Stuart Immonen. Oh man, I found that comic hilarious and gorgeous and just dope. So at some point expect me to cover Next Wave. If you haven't heard of it yet, don't worry, just give it time. I'll bring you up to speed with what makes it special. And if you have heard about it, you probably already know that it's a pretty special comic. By the way, watch Netflix Death, Love, and Robots. It's great. Death, Love, and... Well, thanks, first of all, for all these multiple Super Chats, Pineapple. That's incredibly generous of you. Trust me, I'll do my best to answer your questions even without the Super Chats. But I'll keep that in mind. I will keep that in mind because, as I said, one of the few outlets I have for entertainment these days is Netflix. So I'm always happy to take Netflix recommendations. Tell you, like, my favorite Comic-Con that I really miss because it's on the East Coast and I just can't afford to get to it these days is the Small Press Expo. I like the big conventions, obviously. I go to New York Comic-Con. I just went to Emerald City Comic-Con. I used to, you know, when I was on the East Coast, go to, like, Baltimore and Chicago and stuff like that. But, man, Small Press Expo was my jam because there was so much passion on display with small press, independent press, self-publishing. There was so much passion there. It was always worth taking your time going down, you know, all it is basically is Artist Alley and panels. That's basically all it is. No vendors or special merch. So you just, like, a humongous Artist Alley and you just take your time talking to as many people as you can. Try to get an idea of where their comic is. You might not get every single one, but there's some really funny stuff there and there's some really interesting stuff there. Because I really enjoy nonfiction comics from time to time. I like biographies and I like true crime. So those are two things I really like. Okay, Pineapple resends this chat saying, sorry, Love, Death, and Robots is what it's called. It's got a heavy metal feel to it. All right. I could definitely dig that. You deserve way more recognition from the comics community and in general. If you were to write a comic, would you rather write or illustrate? I'd rather write. I like drawing. As you can see, I'm kind of slow. And I make mistakes and stuff. I'm always trying to get better. That's why I enjoy doing these. I love drawing. I think I've got a ways to go till I sort of like reach where I want to be. But I love writing. I've always written, and I've got like a number of ideas. And if I can get myself to the point where I can afford to hire an artist, I've definitely got several things that I'm in the mood to pitch. So not right now, but hopefully someday in the near future, I can do something like that. Are you going to Fargo, North Dakota Comic Con? Lou Ferrigno is going to be there. I am stoked. Well, yeah. Lou Ferrigno, last I checked, is at like pretty much every convention. What I used to do when I would go to the Wizard World convention in Chicago is he always had a table there. Not like in the celebrity signing areas, just a table. Like, you know, where any sort of vendor could be. And he wasn't always at his table because, you know, he's doing other things, I guess. I don't know. But I liked to sit behind his table and have a friend take a picture of me. And I'd just be doing like strong guy poses and stuff. With like the big Lou Ferrigno sign there. That was something I used to do a lot. Like, not a lot, but I think I did it at least twice. Like two different years. Sorry, Lou. I think he'll forgive me. I've met the Hulk. Lou's a great guy. Oh, that's cool to hear. That's cool to hear. Hello, Gantris. Lou Ferrigno got mad at me when I met him. What'd you do? Kick him in the shin? You just answered my question I was going to ask. It was on doing your own creator-owned book. Yeah, I've got several ideas. I've got a couple sci-fi type ideas, and then I've got, you know, I've talked about this once or twice here. When I first moved out to Seattle, I didn't really know many people. One of the few people I had met that lives out here is a real-life superhero. That's what he calls himself, Phoenix Jones. And so for like the first year that I lived out here, I also suited up as a superhero, and we would patrol the city very late into the night. A lot of times just sort of helping homeless people or drunk people that were like lost or broke, and sometimes breaking up fights, and sometimes administering emergency medical like aid and calling, you know, the EMS. Like, we had some really dramatic times. I did sort of get disillusioned with, like, you know, how effective it all was. And I think that it would make for a funny, interesting, and kind of action-packed comic to sort of tell my story. I would, like, fictionalize the other people involved if I did that. But I was definitely giving some thought to doing something like Harvey Pekar's books, like My Cancer Year and My Movie Year. I was thinking of like My Superhero Year, just to like talk about those crazy adventures that we got ourselves into. People coming at you with knives and stuff. I don't know Master Legend. No, I think he's down in Florida. Yeah. You're very fortunate to still be here. I am. I'm deaf in my left ear, and my parents told me that I could do anything. And look, the Hulk is deaf too. I told him my story and he snapped at me. I'm not deaf. Neither are you. Maybe he misheard. Anyway, yeah. Pretty silly stuff that I think could make for an interesting comic book that would basically, like, me be at the end me telling people, like, probably not a great idea to try to fight crime. Probably not. Yeah, I mean, like I said, we had some interesting adventures. And I definitely helped people. I definitely did. But here's the thing. I didn't need to be dressed like a superhero to do that. You know, it was like, it was, you just need to be willing to step up and help somebody if you see a problem. That's all it needs to be. And I thought that, like, dressing up like a superhero would sort of be like PR and like motivate people, like, wow, people are like actually doing this, like, we should try to be better people. But that really was not exactly what happened. But we were on the news a bunch, you know. We'd get interviewed by like reporters and stuff, and like either on the radio or on TV. It was an interesting time. It was an interesting time, no question. And you know what? If Phoenix still wants to keep doing that, I do respect him for it. I don't think it's bad. I just don't think it's necessary, if that makes sense. And also, like, some of the other people that we patrolled with, some of them I liked, and a couple of them I just did not like at all as human beings. And I was just like, I don't want to hang out with these people. Too weird for me. Not Phoenix, but some of the other people. But yeah, I also have some sci-fi type stories that I've written. I've got like two sort of sci-fi books. Oh, and I wrote a horror story with werewolves that I'd really love to do someday too. So if I can ever get to the position where I feel like I can afford to pay an artist for their work ahead of time, those are some things that I'd like to do personally. But I'm sure that a lot of you out there would also like to do that, right? In Seattle, I'm in Spokane. How often do you come to Spokane? I don't. I don't come out to Spokane. I can't tell me, like, is there like anything sort of touristy to do out there? Is there like a, you know, like park or mountain or anything? Let me know. I have not been to Spokane. I've been to Walla Walla. So that was sort of deserty and dry and very pretty. Is Spokane sort of like that? I'm not sure. You tell me. I've always wanted to throw a bear into space. It's very manly. That's true. That's true. I don't think Lou Ferrigno threw a bear into space, though. I'm pretty sure that didn't he just... He just threw the bear across a pond. I think that that's all he did. Let's see. Just not seeing too many questions, so pardon me for getting quiet. Just doodling along. Woo-hoo-hoo. I think I'm gonna temporarily go back into pencil mode just to see if I can make sure that I know what I want to do over the next few things, next few steps here. I'm gonna do that. Anybody else miss Toys R Us, or is that lame? I feel like I kind of miss them. And I never really shopped there that much, but it was kind of cool to, like, sort of just be able to, like, walk around and see, like, Marvel action figures and stuff like that every once in a while. I kind of miss that. You can sort of see that, I guess, at a lot of, comic book stores, I suppose. Sort of miss that place. Yeah, you still have them in Canada. That's right. I've maybe I'll go to one the next time I go up to Vancouver. I like going to Vancouver. That's a It's a nice city. Actually, my friend Randy from Vancouver is coming down tomorrow. I just remembered. I'm gonna have lunch with him. He's a writer of some like sort of self-published comic book stuff, and he has a fantastic horror comic that he just did. He co-wrote that with Christopher Sabella, if you've heard of that guy. I won't give away his whole thing, but it has to do with it has to do with like some deep Canadian and First Nation history, sort of a zombie story, but really something a little different and deeper than that. It takes place up in like the furthest, like most remote city, or not even a city, just like town that's way up there and way up to the north. I forget exactly what it's called. He hasn't published it yet though, so I'm not like, when it gets published, I'll be definitely giving it a shout out. It looks really cool. I've seen the artwork. The artwork's fantastic. Come to Nova Scotia. I'll give you a lobster and you can go to Toys R Us. All right, I'm gonna break your heart, Jamie's. I don't really like lobster. I know that's terrible. I grew up on the East Coast. Trust me, I'm the bane of my father's existence. He loves cooking lobster. And it drives him nuts that I don't really like it. But hey, it just means I'm a cheap date, right? Remember when you could walk into the mall in the 80s? You could go to KB Toys, then to Walden Books, and then go to the arcade and play Devil Dragon. Now malls are all shoe stores and clothing. Malls are not that exciting, but you're right. Like, they were great back in the day. Yes, I do know about the South African channel called G.I. Joburg. They're some funny, clever guys. That's a good channel, G.I. Joburg. How would I rate Hard Boiled? Zach asks. How would I rate Hard Boiled 1 to 10? If we are talking the comic book, I'd say 7 to 8, mostly for the artwork. I really love Jeff Darrow artwork. The story isn't necessarily that groundbreaking, but it's cool. It's cool. If you're talking the movie with Chow Yun-Fat, 11. That is like one of my all-time favorite action movies. Hard Boiled with Chow Yun-Fat. Oh man, is that is just the baddest ass action movie ever. I love that thing. Just forget about it. No, nothing else comes close for me. I love that thing. Sorry, I'm thinking of like sort of the theme song. Hard Boiled and the Killer. Must watch. Totally agree. Totally agree. What do you think about Batman exposing himself in the recent comic book? I mean, he didn't expose himself to somebody else. He's just walking around the Batcave naked. Kind of weird to me, but whatever. Yeah, man. Wolf Whiskey asks if I've seen the Lobo paramilitary Christmas special. Was I in junior high or high? I was in high school when that came out, and I thought that thing was so dark and badass. But I still love it. I'm a fan of Simon Beasley's artwork. That thing's funny. I like Lobo, actually. I think Lobo could definitely support his own movie. My favorite Lobo story is really a Superman story, and it's not from a comic. It's from that Superman animated show in the 90s, I want to say. Maybe it was 2000s, but I think it was the 90s. And Lobo is hired to capture Superman for like, I don't know, some collectors basically. And they're like, oh, Superman's the last survivor of his planet, so we want to have him. And Lobo successfully takes down Superman, badass, and locks him up, and Superman uses his wits to get out of this one. He taunts Lobo and convinces Lobo to fight him, which breaks, like, they break through some walls until Superman gets to some of the menagerie that these alien collectors have collected over the, like, years and decades and millennia. Specifically, they go to the extinct dodo bird from Earth. And so now he's in an Earth environment. Superman gets all of his powers back, and he beats up Lobo, and he makes a deal with the collectors. He's like, you wanted, like, the last survivor of an alien species? Well, Lobo is the last Zarnian. He's the last of his species because he killed all the rest. And so they lock him up instead. I like that. Like, Superman mostly used his wits to get out of that pickle. That is a good, good story. That's one of my all-time favorites. I love that one. That episode was The Main Man and the Aliens Were the Preservers. Bruce Timm, Superman Lobo. See how awesome he is? Thank you for the super chat, C-Kim. No question. Why didn't Wonder Woman ever get an animated series? Yeah, she probably could have, supported her own. Like, if they leaned heavily into, like, the Greek mythology and stuff like that, I think she probably could have supported her own show. But, you know, they launched, Justice League or Justice League Unlimited, something like that. And, she was definitely, like, you know, one of the main characters there. Anyway, yeah, that was just, I need to rewatch that thing now. I wonder where you can probably, it's all on the DC streaming app, huh? Just thought of that. Don't have that. Well, just another reason to get it someday. Because I've never seen the vast majority of those Batman, Superman, Justice League things. I've seen a small handful. I've seen a good amount of, like, the original Batman, a good amount for the first, like, year or two, but most of that stuff I haven't seen. What other questions are there? You can find it on YouTube? Okay. Lobo versus Deadpool. Well, I guess, Can Deadpool die? If he can, then I guess Lobo wins. What is your favorite episode of Justice League Unlimited? I don't know if I've... I can't think of any. I'm sorry. I just don't know. I haven't seen many. Yeah, I wish I had an opinion on that. I'm definitely curious to check it out someday, but, for now, I don't really know. Well, we're coming along here. This is going okay, I suppose. Not my best, not my worst. Some weird sound going on outside. That's sort of distracting me. I'm not sure what it is. Just hear a weird sound. Whoa! Another super chat. Let's see. What are my thoughts on Spider-Man 500? I haven't read it yet. I'm sorry. I'm not reading a lot of monthly comics right now, folks. Mostly, like, too busy to, like, keep up with everything that's coming out today. So I'm not reading a lot of superhero stuff. If it gets well-reviewed or even if it's infamous for some reason, what I tend to do is I'll pick it up and trade. So you can basically always count on me to be behind the times right now. If I was doing this full-time, I'd definitely be back to buying a bunch of comics every week. Don't have the time or the budget to do that. So I haven't read Spider-Man 500 yet. I would be very curious to. Hopefully I get there. Have I ever been to giantrobot.com? No, I don't think so. I don't think so. Okay. Oh, Spider-Man 500 came out back in 2005? Shoot, excuse me. I thought that like that was like, oh geez, I'm way off on the numbering. Huh. Can't remember it right now though. I'm sorry. If I had my phone, I'd pull it up. I don't have a way to like easily pull up what that was. I'm so sorry. I'm curious now. I'm definitely super curious. Spider-Man 400 was the one where Aunt May supposedly died, I think. So what was 500? That's right, they just had 600, didn't they? What was 500? I can't remember what the big event was. Are you checking out League of Extraordinary Gentlemen lately? No, I read the first two of those. Have not read the more recent ones. Same story, just not always up to date, folks. A little bit more of history. I do read comics regularly still. I just can't like keep up with all the monthly books. So yeah. Just throwing down some heavy blacks on this. I'm gonna shade most of it in, I think. I hope I'm getting this design pretty much right. He's a When you deal with the sort of movie versions, there's so many seams and extra details compared to like a comic book design. All right, let's see. I read NYX. I didn't love it. I like the artwork, but I didn't like the story. Tempest is a slow burn. Okay. Any thoughts on Marvel getting Conan back? Yeah, I mean, the artwork that I'm seeing by that guy, Mahmoud Asrar, looks badass. I think that Conan by Roy Thomas and John Buscema was tops. Like, that's my favorite version. Maybe that's old-fashioned of me, but like I still like I think it really holds up well. I love how Marvel has the rights to Conan and DC has the rights to He-Man, both the perfect counterparts. That would be an interesting crossover, wouldn't it? Did you hear the head of Warner Brothers got fired? I heard that he got fired, but I don't know over what or anything. What would you price the first four issues of Deadpool at? Is that the one that has some of the first artwork by Joe Madureira? Man, I don't know these days. I mean, if you asked me back in the 90s, I'd say like, 25 bucks each. But these days, I don't know, maybe 5 bucks each. There just isn't a lot of demand for vintage comics anymore, unfortunately. It's frustrating, but it's true. When I moved out here 5 years ago, I had 30 long boxes of comics. And I sold them all for $1,000 total. There just wasn't much of a market. You could take your time selling them piecemeal on eBay, and I gave that a shot, but it's very slow going. Most of the sales don't go, and when they do, like it's just for the minimum amount. The sad truth is, so many comics are now available as either trade paperbacks or as digital comics. That there just isn't the same demand for older issues because if somebody wants to read it, they've got much cheaper options available to them. Best Spider-Man artist. Probably have to give it to Steve Ditko for, creating the way Spider-Man moves and looks with his costume and everything like that. And it does hold up, I think, quite well. It's weird, it's very different. So I think you got to give it to Steve Ditko. But then some of my personal favorites after that were I liked Eric Larson a lot when I was a kid. I like Mark Bagley. I like John Romita Jr. I like John Romita Sr. too. There's a lot of fantastic Spider-Man artists. It sort of just, since so many great artists have been able to work on him, it starts to like drill down to like, well, who's your favorite artist, you know? And that's tough to answer. You got interrupted by a commercial break? Sorry, folks. Which comic of yours sold for the most? Oh, well, like I say, I sold them all at once. I sold the entire lot to one person. I was trying to sell them piecemeal, but like they just weren't moving, and it was just going to be too much to store them or to ship them. So I just took the $1,000 and said, okay, I just don't have a massive comic collection anymore. But you know what? It can be a bit of a hassle to like own that many comics and sort of have the responsibility of constantly like moving them and stuff. So I wasn't that upset in some ways. As far as like a comic that I have that's like worth a lot, you know, I did keep a few, and I think if I had to guess, like the most sort of expensive one might be like I've got a few copies of Walking Dead number one, and I'm pretty sure that that's still something that's kind of in demand because it's still in the public consciousness and all, you know. So I think that those would probably be worth the most. It's hard to say for sure. Yeah, I didn't keep much though, so it's, there's not a lot to compare it to. But how about all of you out there? Does anyone own an old or rare comic book that, you know, it, even if it's just a comic that's like rare enough that it means something to you, it's like hard to locate. Like, I'd definitely be curious to hear what all of you out there have that you consider like you know, your favorite or your most valuable comic. I would love to hear that. I'll look up in a sec to see what kind of response that gets. Hopefully there's some cool ones in there. You have a collection of Mad from 1957? That's badass. That's pretty cool. Do you remember one of your first comic books I ever bought? Yeah, it was Transformers. Something like Transformers 27 or something. It was not especially good, but I was very young and I was really into Transformers. So that was one of the first that I bought for myself. Sam Keith's Wolverine is good. Nicolas Cage sold a lot of his comics since some of them got stolen and he wasn't doing anything with them. Yeah, that's a little sad. What else? My grandpa gave me two 1960s reprints of Action Comics number one. Ooh, that's pretty cool. Yeah, I'm a little bit of a wrestling fan. Bullet Club. I like New Japan Pro Wrestling. I like watching, like, you know, pay-per-view every once in a while if a friend offers to invite me over. Let's see. Preacher number one is my most expensive. G.I. Joe number one. I don't know how rare it is, but a copy of Secret Invasion number one. I've got most of the Barry Windsor Smith Conan stuff and the first appearance of Hobgoblin. These are all really great comics, folks. My most treasured comic is Alabaster Wolves. Yeah, I read the old Exterminator books. I cosplayed as Joey Ryan at ECC this year. Very, very cool. The only old physical comic I have is a white-bagged Superman Death, I think. A Marvel 2-in-1. This is going fast. Let's see. A couple of 60s Fantastic Four. Very cool. Oh, Kirby's first issue of 2001 Space Odyssey. Jamie Tron, I'm jealous. That is awesome. I love Kirby's 2001 books. Those are so cool. I know I missed a bunch of you. It just was going too fast. What's my favorite manga? Probably Pluto by Naoki Urasawa. Amazing Spider-Man 129, First Punisher, Days of Future Past, Journey into Mystery, cool. Monster number one in the 70s by Marvel. It featured Werewolf by Night and had the first appearance of Tigra. All of the 80s Alpha Flight books. My most cherished comic is the first appearance of Kitty Pryde. That's pretty cool. What do you think of Spider-Man Shed? I don't know Spider-Man Shed. What's Spider-Man Shed? Is that like shedding his his old identity or something. I don't know Super Spider-Man shit. Marvel Secret Wars number 8. Very cool. X-Men 129. Also very nice. It's so funny. I can, like, most of these that I read, I can actually, like, picture the cover in my head as I read it. Like, it pops in for like, a second. That's it's funny that, like, is, you know, like, you wouldn't think that that's an important thing to remember at all, but, like, it's there for a lot of these. 1960s Superboy. Nice. That's some funny stuff most of the time, and some of it's cool. Draw the Powgon Comics Noir Universer. I don't know what that is. Sorry. I have a copy of Vampirella number 1. Ooh. I don't have much, but I'm treasuring my Kingdom Come issues. Shed is a lizard story. Oh, where the lizard sheds Kurt Connors. Ooh. Magneto and Rogue in the Savage Land. Totally remember. Got you through puberty. That was Jim Lee drawing it then? I feel like he was, but I can't quite remember for sure. I have read the Martian Manhunter series by John Ostrander, but it was honestly like I read it back when it came out. So do I remember it very well? Not that well right now. But I did read it. My most cherished comics are the 4-issue Origin of Beta Ray Bill by Walt Simonson. I love Walt Simonson. I don't think I've done... Oh, no, I did do a Walt Simonson episode when I talked about his Thor run. Excuse me. Because I love Walt Simonson. Shazam number 2 and 3. Right on. Right on. Eerie Comics. I love all the stuff that Frazetta did for Warren Comics. Man, you guys have some good taste. This is really cool to see. There's so many good comics being mentioned here. My favorite manga is the original run of Alita. Sure. Do I need to write a follow-up for that short story for my graphic novel? Yes, you do. Do it right now. Get to work. My first comic was given to me from my aunt. It was an Incredible Hulk and was the issue where he was in Israel. That's right. What was that female superhero's name? Like, she had a magical furry cape. Something like Pravda or something. I can't remember her name. First issue of 2000 AD I bought with my own money. Prague 242. Right on. Sabra. That was like close in terms of how it sounds, but I couldn't think of the name. Sabra. Corbin's Den. Yeah, I remember that. Batman the Cult, I remember. In fact, if you watch my video of all the times Batman has killed, I mentioned how he's a little extra bloodthirsty compared to the Batman of that time period in that book. He kind of lets the cultists just tear apart like some evil reverend. And he's just like, no, Robin, there's just nothing we can do. He's like, well, Batman, we could save that guy. And he's like, nope, we just, he's like 20 feet over there. We just can't. How are we going to get 20 feet across the room? Mirage Studios TMNT numbers 2 through 20. I wonder if I still have my original TMNT stuff. I might have kept some of that. I might have. That was important to me when I was reading it at the time anyway. Cool. Cool stuff, folks. I like what I hear. So what superhero movies or comic book movies this summer are you looking forward to? We've got Hellboy and Shazam, Spider-Man, Avengers, What else? There's got to be some more that I'm not thinking of off the top of my head. Hit me up with it, folks. What are you looking forward to that's comic book adaptation related that you're looking forward to for the summer? Let's see. Akira. I just bought the 35th anniversary box set of Akira so that I could review that soon. Brightburn. That does look interesting. Brightburn looks cool. Hellboy and New Mutants. That's right. I keep forgetting about New Mutants. I wonder if that will actually get released, though. Have I checked out any of the comics by Charles Forsman? One of his books got turned into a Netflix series. What Netflix series is that? The End of the... Oh, yes. I did read The End of the World. I'm censoring myself so that this can stay monetized. I did read that book. I noticed in one of your videos, inside your comic book rack, you have a copy of Shatter, which I believe is the first computer-generated comic. What are your thoughts on it? It's not that great, but it's just sort of an interesting novelty. I think I got it in like the dollar bin or maybe even the quarter bin. It's interesting. Endgame, Hellboy, Shazam. What's my favorite DC character? Probably Batman. I do think that there's a lot you can do with him. I think that when I was younger, Deathstroke was way up there. I do think that there's a lot of stuff you can do with Deathstroke that's pretty cool. What else stands out? It's hard to say. Lobo, yeah. Day of the Rope. I don't know that one. John Wick 3 does look cool. Somebody's mentioning Talkie Tawny. I think if the Shazam gets a sequel, we could see Talkie Tawny and Mr. Mind. I think so. Joker is coming out later in the year. Oh, yeah. That I don't know what to make of, to be honest. I don't know what to make of that one. Just going to add some sort of pockmarks and sort of small gouges type detail to this duster because it's leather and all. Had a few folds over here. Make sure that the shadows look okay at least. I think that the thing that I want to get better at in terms of like the inking is my feathering techniques. I don't like just sort of scratchy hash lines that don't mean anything. I like to really give some thought to where I decide to feather it, and some of it's okay. I don't quite get it the way it's in my head, so that's a technique that I would like to get better at personally. We'll see. All you can do is sort of keep practicing and hope for the best. I'm making a cameo. Flappy folds, Terry flaps. Hold my foldy holds. Lick my foldy flaps. You gotta touch 'em. What do I think of Nick Spencer's new Amazing Spider-Man run? Well, unfortunately, like I was mentioning earlier, I'm not always up to date on like comics, but I did flip through. I think that Ryan Otley is a very good choice for a Spider-Man artist, but as far as Nick Spencer's writing goes, I'm sorry, I just I'm not up to date. I don't know what he's doing with the character right now. So at some point, I'll catch up, but probably in like a trade paperback type deal. Good question. Sorry, don't always have an informed opinion on each of these comics. Wish I did. If I could do this full time, trust me, I'd be doing like some sort of smaller reviews of stuff that's coming out like right now and stuff, like more recent stuff. I would like to do something like that, but just no time. Just no time. I love your Love and Rockets episode. Thank you. Thank you so much. I remember commenting that that awesome T-80s goth band Love and Rockets took their name from the comic. Have you ever listened to them? I haven't. I haven't. What is your opinion of KN? I assume that you're trying to get me to say like an offensive slang word. Is that the joke here? That's weird. I don't know what you're talking about, man. I hope I'm misunderstanding. I don't think The Rock is really in the Shazam movie, though. No, I don't think The Rock is still attached to being Black Adam. I think that like just took too long to happen. He doesn't really need it now, does he? He's kind of got like plenty of franchises and stuff. He could just do Fast and Furious stuff if he wanted to. Thanks for binging, folks. Nice to hear some that people like it. That's really cool. Have you ever watched any of the live-action Junji Ito movies? No, I haven't. You're saying they're hilariously bad? I've also heard some not flattering reviews, so I think I just prefer to stay with the comics. Someone's asking, what do I think of Channing Tatum as Gambit? I'll be honest, I don't think they made it fast enough. And, so I don't think that's going to happen. Uzumaki was good? Sean Connery never had hair either, but he rocked his movies. Nice. Have you ever read the miniseries called White Trash put out by Tundra? No, I've heard of it, but I haven't read it. What do I think of Jeffrey Dean Morgan as Lobo? Yeah, maybe. He's got a good attitude to it. He's definitely sort of got the voice and the swagger and stuff like that. He's a good actor, man. He is, but you know, they'd have to sort of give him a fake, like, sort of bodysuit, probably. But, yeah, maybe. It's not a bad idea. Definitely not a bad idea. All right, see ya, Marvel Rocks. If I ever get my book published, I'll be sure to send you a copy. That's nice. Danny Trejo is Lobo. Yeah, he's sort of the real-life Lobo. New 52 Lobo is good. They should make a New Mutants a direct-to-streaming movie. Don't be surprised if that's exactly what happens. I mean, as of now, Marvel owns Disney. Marvel owns Disney. Excuse me, that doesn't make sense. Back up, do it again. Disney now owns 20th Century Fox. I'll be honest, I don't know if New Mutants or even Dark Phoenix will actually get theatrical releases. Don't be surprised if they pull those at the last minute and decide to release them as streaming only. I'm totally serious that I could see that happening, because at this point, they've got to, like, give people a breather so that they can, like, reboot and put that stuff in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Because they're going to. Even if they reboot the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Like, so, I don't know. Gambit, I don't think that's getting made. And the reviews for Dark Phoenix are pretty terrible, unfortunately. Now, that's not necessarily the way we, the audience, will react to it, but the early word of mouth is that it ain't that good. I could see Disney just deciding, like, hey, we didn't really invest in this. We just, like, own the property now. Let's just release it to streaming. Aw, J-Muse, thank you so much for the super chat. Thanks for creating a great channel and community. That's very kind of you to say. Universal doesn't have the rights to Hulk. They have the rights to distribute a Hulk-only movie. Close, you know? Basically, Marvel/Disney couldn't do just a Hulk movie on their own. They can use the Hulk however they see fit, throwing him into anything else. They have the rights to him. They just don't have the full distribution rights for just Hulk. Weird, right? Who's my favorite character to draw? Probably Spider-Man. I love drawing Spider-Man. I always have. Batman is up there, too. Cool question. Am I the only one who finds Brie Larson incredibly annoying? You know what? I've got sort of like mixed opinions on Brie Larson. I'll be honest. I think she's a good actress. I really do. I've liked a lot of the TV shows and movies that she's done. I do. I don't think she's bad at all. I think she's quite talented. In person, when she does interviews, I don't connect with her personality, like her real life personality. But that just means she's that much more of a good actress, because I don't see that in her work. I think she's talented, man. I don't think she's a bad Captain Marvel at all. I do find... I wouldn't say that the Captain Marvel movie was great. I can't say that. But I did think it was good. I thought it was entertaining. I think it could have been a better movie if they made a few different changes in writing. Okay? I think that, like, if they had written that movie completely linearly, it might have worked better. I know that sounds a little more mundane, but I saw that Captain Marvel, and I thought of the movie RoboCop, where the main character is not themselves until the end. So if we had sort of been able to see who Carol Danvers is and get to like her, and then see her turned into something else, we would sort of be aligned with her and want to root for her. They could have also done some more comedy with, like, if she was more of a blank slate, like fish out of water stuff on Earth. And then she ultimately would have triumphed by reclaiming her identity. Instead, like, she still sort of had a personality. It was just sort of subdued. And so I don't blame her as an actress. I think she played the material the way it was written. I really do think that. I don't think she did a bad take on it at all. So I'm very curious to see what she'll be like in Avengers Endgame. I really do. I think that the movie Captain Marvel was still pretty fun. I just think it could have been better if it had a more linear story, essentially. Maybe there wouldn't have been quite as many sort of surprises or reveals, but I think we might have connected with the main character more. We'll see. You know, it's easy for me to Monday morning quarterback this thing. She was great as Envy and Scott Pilgrim. She was. And if you've ever seen Room, it's pretty amazing work. It really is. I also liked her on that show Community. I found her very likable and charming on that. So, you know, as a person, like when she's in interviews and stuff, I don't connect with her very, very much. But I don't care. I don't have to like a person if they're a good actor or actress. So that's my two cents on things. Your mileage may vary. They should have made a Ms. Marvel movie. I would love a modern day, like, Kamala Khan Ms. Marvel movie. I think that could be a lot of fun. I think that like a lot of people would connect with that character because she's funny and has cool powers, a good look, cool background. I think that like Marvel kind of botched it with their Inhumans take. So that's one of their biggest missteps, in my opinion, is what they did with Inhumans. They just went cheapo on that, and it's too bad because a few of the actors in it are actually quite good, but that was bad. That was really bad. I didn't even get through it all. I gave up after like maybe three episodes, I think. So that was pretty unfortunate. That said, technically, Ms. Marvel is Inhuman, so like maybe they could like bring that back. I think that they're going to use some of the Inhuman mythology when they get to the Eternals, because the Eternals are sort of close. They're all related. It's all to do with like Kree meddling and genetic tampering by like Celestials and stuff like that. So it all sort of connects. Would you ever cover the Scott Pilgrim comic? Maybe. Wow, thanks, Philip Sasko. Good writing will do her well. Agreed, agreed. Just gotta get good writers. That's where you start. That's where you start on all of this stuff. Thank you so much though for the super chat, Phil. That's super nice of you. I sincerely appreciate it. Saw an interesting movie last weekend called Lords of Chaos, and it's based on a true story of the Norwegian black metal band called Mayhem, which had one of their members commit suicide and another killed the leader of the band, went to jail for it. It was pretty interesting. I didn't love it. Found the characters a little annoying, but it was still it's real, so it's an interesting little bit of history. I think it could have used more music, but it was interesting. If you're into either true crime or that sort of Norwegian metal history stuff at all, you might enjoy it. You might get something more out of it than the average person. I don't know. I guess I'm almost done. I'm close. Yeah. I don't feel like there's a lot more I can do with this, with my skill level. I'm pretty happy with this. I hope that the person that commissioned it ends up happy with it. Yeah, she is better. Captain Marvel is better in the movie than she was in Civil War 2. See ya, J. Andrew World. Varg was portrayed super poorly in that movie. He ranted about that on his channel. Yeah, I'm sure that the real life person doesn't appreciate it, but at the same time, like, I don't think the movie was obligated to do right by him. He's a murderer, so I don't think that like I say, it wasn't a great movie. It was interesting. But anyway, that's all. I need to get a kneaded eraser because now it's time to clean this up and I don't have a way to do that. You know what I'll do instead is I think I'll switch to coloring this in. Oh shoot, but I don't know what colors this guy is. Well, I think he has blonde hair, so I'm gonna just do a little bit. And I think he has orange pants and obviously he has skin color skin. So, if I can just find the right tools for that. Yeah, I think this is the right color. No, that's too dark. Maybe I can't color this right now. Darn it. I found an eraser. I'm going to see if it works at all. Okay. So I'm just going to clean this up a little, see if it looks maybe a touch better by getting rid of some of the old pencil lines and making things look a little sharper. But what questions do we have? Orange jacket. Naruto usually wears red. See, yeah, I'm already coming across a couple different things. Chris, came across a fun G.I. Joe channel you might like called G.I. Joeberg. Somebody else mentioned that one. I'm aware of G.I. Joeberg. I think I've even talked to those guys, like, online. Every year, a friend of mine that has a channel called Hooded Cobra Commander 788 does sort of a community event around G.I. Joe where different G.I. Joe-themed YouTube channels all participate. We come up with a theme together. I say we because I've participated in the last couple. And G.I. Joeberg is in there. So we have sort of a forum for just the participants. And those guys are really cool. They're funny and they're talented and they do something very unique. Yeah, G.I. Joeberg's a good channel if you're into G.I. Joe at all. I plan on this July participating again. I know that, like, you know, you might say, like, well, you've covered G.I. Joe like a couple times already, and yep, that's true, but what can I say? I grew up with it, I love it, and I like participating in this event, and I've got an interesting angle this year to cover some comics that probably most people out there have not heard of before, so I think it'll sort of be interesting and fun. I think it can be very cool. Star-Lord is way better in the movies, just like Thor. Thor has some great comics. Don't sleep on the stuff by Walt Simonson. That stuff's great. And personally, I also really like a lot of what Jason Aaron has done with the character. So Thor does have some good comics. Star-Lord, not as much. I definitely agree there that, like, the comics these days are totally informed by what they've done in the movies. And that's fine. I think that, like, they've got a good angle on him. Slightly improved origin. The best comic I think that, like, Star-Lord was in was possibly Marvel's Annihilation crossovers. Not crossovers, more just an event, right? I do think that those were good. He didn't play a huge major role, but he was important to them, and he was in them. He looked way different than he does now, but that's okay. He had like a cyborg eye, dark hair, wore a different suit. Unrecognizable almost. But anyway, looks like I think I'm about done here. I will color this. I don't know if I've got all the right colors here right now. Let me see. Actually, I might do some of these in like the grays. I like to color things in cool grays. Thor is like the Hulk for me. There have been a few great stories, but overall the comic isn't that great. Well, I think that there's some good ones, but I understand. How difficult is it to get a comic published in Heavy Metal magazine? You usually have to already be known. It's got a new editor, I believe. Because it was Grant Morrison, and I want to say Tim Seeley just took over. So, yeah, I guess just pitch it to Tim Seeley if I've got that right. I'm pretty sure that I do. Favorite indie comic? The original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. I like those. Wow, Sans Sanity. Thank you for the more or less last minute super chat. That's so nice of you. I sincerely appreciate that. Thank you. Do you think Adam Warlock will be properly adapted? I think that, like, he'll be an interesting character, but if he's not getting in his own movie, and he probably isn't, and he doesn't, like... they're going to just use some of his story, but I don't think that we're going to get to know Adam Warlock on a deep level. If he's well handled, and even if he's in Guardians of the Galaxy 3, which we don't know for a fact, but if he's handled well, I could see them giving him a spinoff. Would I do an Ed Piskor episode? I would like to, but I'd also sort of like to collaborate with him. So we'll see. What you find? Oh, my fiance just gave me a gift that I got for Christmas from her. This is an unboxing episode now. This is a kneaded eraser. It's by Generals. It's a jumbo kneaded eraser. So let's unbox this and take a look at this product. I did do sort of an episode a little bit about Adam Warlock. It was mostly about Jim Starlin. I have read The Green River Killer. I believe I met the artist that did it this past Emerald City Comic Con. He was confronted by a friend of one of the victims. I mean, that's too bad, but you know, it's a story worth telling. I don't think it was designed to hurt anyone, so it is too bad if it did. It is too bad. But Green River Killer is an interesting comic. Look at this, folks. It's wrapped really well, so this kneaded eraser is in great condition. I'm unwrapping it, and oh my god, it seems to be made of kneaded rubber. Oh my. Look at that. Look at that. Yep, it twists and turns and does all sorts of amazing things. Let's see how it erases. Oh, it's perfect. Oh, there's no shavings, and it picks that up, but it doesn't smear or smudge. Oh, it's even cleaning up the little eraser marks that I had made it earlier. So look at that. That is just, and then I'll just sort of twist that around to a new piece. Folks, you heard it here first. General's Jumbo Kneaded Eraser is a decent kneaded eraser. I kneaded an eraser. That's exactly right. Everybody's thanking Chrissy. Eraserhead's gonna rub you out. You can always trust the better half to save the day. Look at that. Now that's a good gift. Now that's a Christmas present. Look at that. Oh, that's great. Now I can keep erasing to my heart's content. Oh, everything looks beautiful. It's making my drawing better. The drawing looked terrible, and now it looks average. I'm just kidding around. That's cool. That's actually super helpful. Kneaded erasers are great. They don't smudge. They don't, at least not like other erasers. So, very cool. Very cool. Yep, that works well. That works very well. I think that'll do it for this episode, everybody. This was a really fun one. Thank you for so many interesting questions. I loved the break we took in the middle where people talked about some of the comics you own that to you are exceptionally valuable. So many of you were super generous about these super chats. Thank you. That's all I can say. That's really appreciated. That's just really kind of you. And I'll probably be doing another one of these very soon because, like I say, I'm doing a bunch of commissions to support a friend, and I've still got to color these. But I don't remember his whole color scheme, so I can't really do a good job right now. And this one, I'm giving some serious thought to coloring in grays instead of color, but I'm gonna give it like some thought. But I've got some more. I know I've been asked to do Buffy the Vampire Slayer. What else have I been asked to do? One, two, three, four. There's two more that I've been asked to do, and they're not coming to me right now. I think one of them is Lone Ranger. It's hard to remember. But anyway, that'll do it for tonight. I actually am going to go work on the next Comic Tropes episode that you can expect this Sunday. I sincerely appreciate everybody continuing to watch, subscribe, share. Just remember to smash that like button. Where did that phrase ever come from? Every channel says, remember to smash that like button. What do you. I don't want you to smash anything. You'll break your damn computer if you smash it. Don't smash that like button. You're allowed to just click it. I'd appreciate it if you just clicked it. That doesn't sound as exciting, but I don't want you smashing your keyboard. That's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. What are these people thinking? Are they thinking? Oh, all right. Thanks for letting me be silly and rant. I will see you all very soon, and take care of yourselves. All right, keep reading comics. All right, and of course, as I say that, I get a bunch of pop-ups here. Okay, they're nothing. Folks, I'm leaving for real. Keep reading comics.